Okay, so the recording is underway, so I think we'll get started. Once again, good morning, everyone. Welcome to today's OAST Network coaching session entitled Telling the Active School Travel Story. The goal of today's session is to strengthen our collective ability to communicate with and engage others in our active school travel work by exploring some of the key principles of effective storytelling, as well as sharing some inspiring examples from across the network. As always, the session is being recorded and will be posted to the network workspace on Slack. We have four speakers with us today to help tell the story of storytelling, and I will introduce each one of them before their presentations. There will also be a few minutes at the end of each segment for questions, so please use the chat box for your questions or comments. We've also set aside some time at the end of today's session for what I'm calling an open forum, where you're welcome to share other examples and ideas of effective storytelling, whether from your local AST programs or examples from beyond the world of active school travel. This is by no means a comprehensive presentation of all the really good storytelling that's been going on across the network. So we wanted to have some time at the end of the session for people to talk about their own examples or ask other questions, just have a bit of an open conversation about storytelling. So to get things started, I'm pleased to introduce my colleague, Fenella Hood, who is our communications coordinator at Ontario Active School Travel. Fenella is going to take us through a general overview of storytelling, why it matters, and how it can strengthen the work that we do. So over to you, Fenella. I'll release the screen.
Thank you, Wallace. Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, loud and clear.
Can you see my screen?
I can. Away we go.
Good morning, everyone. Humans have always been telling stories. Long before modern language and writing, Paleolithic cave paintings show the importance of recording events, challenges, and conflicts in pre-civilization. These societies held their cultural history and sharing of knowledge in as high a regard as collecting food. The sharing of the collective history of people was tantamount to survival. By passing on the knowledge of animal migrations, dangerous areas, medical practices, the crafting of tools and technology, they increase the chances of survival of their children, people, their culture as a whole. They knew storytelling is the ultimate form of self-preservation. In sub-Saharan Africa, oral storytelling was vital for survival. In this birthplace of humanity, geography played a huge role in isolating groups of people within miles of each other. Key individuals were tasked with the responsibility of learning, memorizing, and retelling the stories of the tribe. The ancient and intimate tradition of oral storytelling passed on lessons and knowledge essential to living. In oral storytelling, the teller and audience are close to each other, often sitting together in a circle, like around a campfire. Through the telling of story, they develop a connection to one another through a communal experience. The storyteller reveals and shares themselves as through their telling, and the listeners do the same through the reception of the story. Storytelling nurtures a personal bond with the teller and the receivers. It is a bond that is remembered. I'm no expert on storytelling, but my environmental visual communication course at the ROM culminated in our cohort creating a presentation on storytelling for an afternoon slot during a two-day Oceans 2020 symposium, where scientists across Canada presented findings to a large public audience. We shared our stories through video, photography, a dance, if I remember correctly, and oral poetry and stories. We were there at the symposium to demonstrate that it is through the medium of storytelling that the message will stick and ignite change. Scientific data just isn't good enough. Stories are what can make the difference. Nothing sticks in our heads better than a story. Facts don't persuade, feelings do. And stories are the best way to get at those feelings. At one point during our presentation, we asked people in the audience to turn to the person next to them and spontaneously tell that stranger a 2-minute story. then switch and the other person tell theirs. The auditorium became alive with animated voices, laughter, and joy. At the end of our session time slot, we asked people to volunteer a hand up and tell us what they enjoyed most. And there was an overwhelming response that the interactive storytelling to their neighbor activity was their most memorable takeaway. We love to connect. We love to share. And stories are memorable. I'd like you to think about a two-minute story you might be willing to share with us in a few.
Fenella? I think we may have lost Fenella. Are you still there, Fenella? Let me just check in the chat box. She said that she had been periodically having some internet connection issues where she lives. In which case, we may have to jump to the next presentation and come back to Fenella. And that indeed appears to be what has happened. Well, this is just the morning for technical glitches here at Ontario Active School Travel. Caroline, just be on standby. I'm just going to see whether or not Fenella's coming back quickly or not. I'm going to text her. Sorry, everybody. If you could be lined up to go, Caroline.
I am ready whenever I'm needed.
Okay. I thought if Fenella can come back quickly. Okay, I don't see her reappearing right away, so I think we're going to jump ahead and come back to Fenella's introduction. But we'll jump ahead. We'd hoped that she was going to run us through, as I say, sort of a bigger picture introduction to storytelling, and then move on to some more specific examples, but technology is not our friend this morning, and I still don't see Fenella in the room. So, Caroline, I think we're going to switch things up and move over to you. So I'll let you get your presentation lined up.
I'm all set.
Okay, so if you want to start sharing your screen. So I wanted to introduce Caroline Cox from Eco Superior in Thunder Bay. And we invited Caroline to share some examples of how they have been very effectively using photography and videography to tell the story of the Walk or Wheel Thunder Bay project in Thunder Bay. And I know Caroline's going to be doing the presentation this morning, but her colleague April Hadley is also on the call from Thunder Bay District Health Unit. And I know not only is she played a major role in the project along with Caroline, but also in developing this presentation. So over to you, Caroline.
All right, thanks, Wallace. So April and I work very closely on this program called Walker Wheel Thunder Bay. It's a new as in beginning with first round funding project in Thunder Bay, and we're working very closely with four schools. And yes, April developed our beautiful presentation today, so thank you for her. And she's going to help with questions at the end. So we thought that it was really important to document our activities using photographs and videos. This is something that we budgeted for in our initial application to participate in this program. And we really wanted to highlight what we achieved. We have put together a video series with Apple Wagon Films. So what we wanted to do was we wanted to feature each of our schools, each of our four schools that we're working closely with in a video, and to feature champions at that school. And then there's also a legacy video that's going to be coming out pretty soon. We just finished it. And that overall highlights, it gives a bigger picture of the stakeholders involved and the project as a whole and its success. So to get into some specific examples, previews to the videos are showing up. Awesome. So the first four videos each profile a different school, focusing on the school travel champion. So, and each video is released in tandem with one of the walk and wheel events as part of the promotions for that event. So International Walk to School Week, which is the video we'll be showing in a minute, features a very active park and stride program at St. Thomas Aquinas School. We did a video for Winter Walk Day featuring a walking school bus at Ecole Grand Morgan. It's a very active group that's been going on for a number of years with a parent volunteer and a group of kids. And we wanted to feature them in winter, both because we think it's really important to kind of tell that story with the winter footage, because we get a lot of pushback. Well, what about winter? How can I travel actively in winter? So we wanted to make sure that that was part of the storytelling. But also specific to this group, I've heard from three different parents statements like, it was minus 40 today and I offered to drive Theo to school, but he said, no, mom, I walk. I've heard that from three different parents. So these were a great champion group to feature as part of our winter video. Bike Week, we have a very active teacher at St. Margaret who has been working to bring cycling to that school. He's certified as a bike rodeo instructor and helps to deliver bike rodeos in that school. So we thought that that was an awesome pairing for our Bike Week feature. And then Active April, which is what we call Spring into Spring. We wanted to feature Edgewater Park. They have a group called Walking at the Edge. And what that is that every class will go for a short daily walk as part of their phys ed and physical literacy, just like daily physical activity. So that's been really awesome. And then as I mentioned, we are doing a legacy video. April and I are both interviewed in that video, and also the manager of Student Transportation Services of Thunder Bay, who's been very involved in the project. So that video is a little bit more of an overview and has more focus on the stakeholder group. And at this point, I'll stop my share and I'll get Wallace to share the St. Thomas Aquinas video.
Great, Caroline, and I am looking for the videos. There they are. Okay, phew, I thought I'd lost those too. Does that look like yours, Caroline? This is the one, Caroline?
Wallace, it's April. I don't know if that is.
Yeah,
our...
that's it.
Yep. Okay. Away we go, everybody. And I'm just going to check.
It doesn't seem like the audio is working, though.
My apologies. This is going to go down as the most technically glitched okay, I'll have to stop share. I will do it again. I'll try sharing the computer sound this time. Okay, Wallace, learn something new every day. Okay, hopefully we got the sound this time, folks.
St. Thomas Park and Stride is an active transportation program that allows families from our community to drop off their child at a location that is off-site. It is supervised by either a staff member or a parent volunteer. We want to encourage families to walk to school for two reasons. One, you know, we want to support the evidence that shows that activity better prepares students for learning. And secondly, we want to create a safer environment around our school, and we want to create that safe, fun environment for children to walk to school.
the park and stride is you get dropped off at the board office and you walk with your friends and your teacher to the school. I like that I can get to know more people in the younger grades, and I get to get out in nature and walk, and I like to get fresh air.
I think the park and stride program is important to our school community. We want our children to come into our learning environment prepared and ready to meet all the demands of the curriculum.
Okay, Caroline, back to you.
Okay, awesome. I will share my screen again. Perfect. So we did one video kind of along those lines in terms of the storytelling for each of our four participating schools. And in addition to that, we have worked with Dan Garrity Media to do a lot of storytelling around photography. So these are still photographs, again, featuring each of our participating schools at school assemblies, walkabouts, facilitated discussions, and those four major Ontario Active School Travel events. And it's been pretty great to work with Dan, partially because his daughter is a student, not at one of our four participating schools, but at another school that we work with closely, mostly on cycling initiatives. So Dan has actually sometimes he came to his daughter's class to take pictures for free, which was really lovely of him. But this is, most of these are Dan's pictures here. So school assemblies, walkabouts, facilitated discussions, and then the right top photo is the new school safety patrol that was created at a Colgron Morgan. Right bottom is the new school route signs. So this is, you know, it's pretty exciting, and we want to make sure that we have a wide range of photos. We have our initiatives represented so we can recognize them. And then you'll see there are more winter photos here. So just make sure that we have a diversity of images. The results are that the champion videos have over 20,000 views on Facebook. They're often shown at schools, for instance, at school assemblies. They gain a lot of momentum around parent groups, which is totally fantastic because that's an awesome stakeholder group. And then also just in terms of our organizational stakeholders and those decision makers at the table and at those committee meetings. And then we wanted to make sure that the stakeholders and the decision makers also feature really prominently in the videos and images. So one example of that, that actually we haven't had a photo from in this presentation, but that's fine. Shelby Chung is the city councilor who represents two of the schools in our program, and she's been very involved in this and in other active transportation initiatives. And she actually won the Share the Road Wheels of Change award at last year's Bike Summit. So it's been awesome to have some photos that kind of document her involvement as well. And that's what we have today. So April and I are happy to take questions. Wallace, are we doing questions now or at the end?
Yeah, if anybody has any quick questions. I am trying to bring up the chat box, which I'm unable to do right now. Oh, there it is. Okay. Yeah, so if anybody has any questions for Caroline or for April, just pop those into the chat box. I know I have one, so maybe I'll put that out there now, Caroline. Without getting into to the specifics, obviously you built this photography and videography piece into your project plan and into your project budget because you did engage a local professional to help you create all of this amazing visual material. And I'm just wondering, off the top of your head, as a percentage of your overall budget for the project, could you give folks sort of a rough idea of, like, is this a very costly thing? Did you have to sacrifice other things in your project in order to do this?
So our budget for the videos was about $5,000, and that got us five videos, which we did get quite a deal on that. The photography doesn't entirely come out of this budget. It partially comes out of this budget and partially comes out of our Safe Cycling Thunder Bay budget. And I want to say that we have spent $300 to $500 on photography. And then in addition to having Dan at events, because we can't have him everywhere, we do supplement it with photography that April or I or a teacher might take.
Okay, but as an overall, you know, sort of a percentage of the of the total budget, it's not an overwhelming percentage, I'm assuming.
No, yeah, it would be about $5,500 of an $86,000 budget.
Okay, okay. The reason I asked is I know that you're perhaps the only project that we're aware of, at least those that are supported by the Ontario Actors School Travel Fund, that that has done this. So it's it was interesting to know. There is a question, a couple of questions in the chat box from Laura Zeglin. Great work, Caroline and April. But thinking this feels like a lot of work to create these visual materials. What are the plans to make sure they get used to their full potential over the longer term?
April, do you want to take that one or do you want me to?
You can go ahead if you have some things off the top of your head and I'll pop in if I can help you out.
Okay, that sounds good. So with the videos that were created, we do, as those annual events come up again, we promote those videos again. That is the main thing that we've done with the videos. And then, yeah, I guess bringing them up again when we go back to the schools, you know, when we do additional assemblies down the road, or sometimes we present awards to classes. So those are places that we have integrated it in addition to the kind of promotion as part of the annual event. And then there are two local TV networks. TBATEL, I think that their videos are shown online, and then Shaw has a local TV channel, so they will allow for community submissions of videos. So we have submitted the videos through those mediums as well. And then in terms of the photography, it's a little bit more sporadic, but we use the pictures a lot in various promotions. So for instance, this week we launched our virtual bike rodeo, and we did use some of Dan's photos in those bike rodeos. So we just, you know, just the promotional materials that'll come up as you do new things, that's where the pictures have been most useful.
Okay. Great, thanks Caroline. There are a couple of other questions in the chat box, but in the interest of time, I'm gonna let you answer those in the chat box, Caroline and April, if you don't mind. And sure. Fenella has returned. So Fenella, we're going to turn things back over to you.
Great. Sorry about that. How embarrassing.
It's a morning of glitches. So,
I just truly have my fingers crossed it won't happen again, because I do have patchy internet here in this small town of mine. So I think I was here, and I'll just repeat myself a little bit to the beginning and plow through. So we love to connect, we love to share, and stories are memorable. And I'd like you to think about a 2-minute story you might be willing to share with us in a few slides time. A short story on the theme of story. It may be a story you've told many times to friends. It may be a spontaneous off-the-cuff story for you this morning. It may be AST related or not. Maybe the first story you remember being told, the first storybook you read to your child, or a story about something in your AST community that you keep meaning to tell. I'll call on any volunteers willing to share in a few slides time. From the romantic troubadours of medieval Europe to the authors and performers of modern times, storytelling hadn't changed much. But technology brought a huge shift. We don't have to go buy a ticket and visit the theater. We can stream a video or listen to a concert any time of the day from wherever we want. Storytelling is literally in the palm of our hands. Digital storytelling is the modern extension of the art of storytelling. Thanks to new media and digital technologies, individuals can approach storytelling from unique perspectives, and everyday people use digital tools to share their stories. Every day, moment to moment, through video photography, audio, or any other form of non-physical media. That's material that exists only as electronic files, as opposed to actual paintings or photographs on paper, sound stored on tape or disc, movies stored on film. Digital stories are often in compelling and emotionally engaging formats, as their multimedia diversity combine a variety of communicative elements within narrative structure.
As the new form of storytelling, digital storytelling emerged with the advent of accessible media production techniques, hardware and software such as digital cameras, digital voice recorders, and audiovisual editing software, and put YouTube, podcasts, and social media into our vocabulary. In addition to digital storytelling, there is also now transmedia storytelling, which is an emerging subject because of the nature of new media and different platforms. It's the technique of telling a story across multiple platforms and formats, communicating narratives through a multitude of integrated media channels with the goal to create content that engages a wide audience, using various techniques to permeate their daily lives. For example, a brand may produce comic books before the release of its related films to the audience, understands a character's backstory, or coloring books to attract younger audience members. In order to achieve this engagement, a transmedia production will develop stories across multiple forms of media technology to deliver unique pieces of content in each channel. Fan fiction is an extension of transmedia storytelling, an audience now creating the content. From prehistoric fire-telling stories to Instagram stories, we have known that stories are powerful tools. People gain power through telling stories. The teller has the listener's attention and can steer the audience to win them over to their side. Whether for political propaganda or entertainment, when a story is told well, it connects with an audience. It can move people into action, go viral, and start a revolution, or even change the face of a community or society. A good story has a hero. The hero's journey is classic story structure. Think of Homer and his Song of Achilles or Rocky Balboa. A tale as old as time, where a character goes on an adventure, faces conflict, and ultimately triumphs over adversity and gains the reward. We want to hear the hero's story, and that is why personal stories affect us, tug at our emotions, and can move us to action. No matter what the purpose or what the medium, if we master the art of storytelling, our message will be successful. It is story itself that's important. So a good story has power, the power to inspire, the power to energize, and the power to move people to action. Good stories have the power to build understanding, to entertain, to teach, to humanize the big picture. Most importantly, good stories have the power to be remembered. We all have the ability to tell stories. It's part of our DNA, passed down from the beginning of humankind. Stories have been called the connective tissue of the human race. And as young children, we instinctively learn to tell stories, and we yearn for stories to be told to us. But as we grow up, our natural storytelling nature can wane. It's time to dust off and start thinking in stories again. Everyone can tell a story, and telling stories of the work you do can be a role for every person in your organization and community to take on. Everyone must play. In fact, it's the only way to ensure that great stories come to light. We want to create a movement of active school travel, so we need to create a culture of AST storytelling and share our stories. If everyone understands the role of stories in an organization and feels that they are valued for their contribution, then you start to build a storytelling culture that positively feeds and supports program development, continuous improvement, human resources, evaluation, marketing, fundraising, the list goes on. So what are the components of a good story? It's still the five W's, the who, what, when, where, and why, and the four C's, character, content, context, and creation. If the first three C principles define the story, the fourth one, creation, defines the telling. Creation pulls together characters, context, and conflict into one comprehensive narrative. The greatest characters and most interesting conflict in the world are no good if they aren't shared in a compelling way. Every storyteller has their own unique voice and style. These both come to play as you craft the story in your own way. From the words used to how the narrative is structured, creativity plays an important role in the storytelling process. And two virtues really matter when creating: clarity and consistency. A story is no good if it's too confusing or can't agree with itself. As long as you remain clear and consistent, you can't go wrong. J.K. Rowling said, "No story lives unless someone wants to listen." To get people to listen, to keep on reading or watching, we need to reel them in. So first, there is the hook. Future Nobel Prize winners coming through. We keep reading because we want to know how our kids can become Nobel Prize winners. Other narrative tools can add to the effectiveness of the message getting through. Tom Flood's choice of music in this short video evokes our emotions and tugs on our heartstrings. I'll hand it over to you, Wallace, to play the video. Hopefully it will be less glitchy than here.
Okay. And hopefully I will remember. Okay, we're starting with that one, right, Fenella? A humble bike.
You bet.
Okay. Hopefully the volume is at a good setting. I know I blasted out some ears on the during the dress rehearsal. Here we go.
Okay, thanks, Wallace. So,
go ahead.
Okay. So, that was Tom Flood's first video. We're going to watch a second video of his. In this video, it's entitled A Lifetime of Firsts. Tom uses his personal story of his son's journey with the bike riding growing up and uses a video add-on, a digital trompe l'oeil, to make the film look like it was shot on a vintage film reel. This whimsical journey could be any of our stories. Thanks, Wallace. So personal stories work, but not everyone has the capacity to include professional photo or video lines in the funding, or even a line for communication period. But everyone can seek out story and tell a personal story, either one of their own or one they have observed. You don't need all the fancy video know-how, and getting kids to tell the story is really effective. Wallace, if you don't mind showing the last video, this fun, lighthearted video from Everactive Schools is from their Get Kids Out series.
Sorry, I didn't think we were going to the other videos so quickly. So,
sorry.
Fine, there we go.
Start from the beginning there, Wallace.
Yeah.
Thanks.
And we're ready to go?
Yeah.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Ben from Get Kids Out, and I'm about to tell you about an awesome new program by Everactive Schools. It's called Explore Your 2.4. You're probably wondering, why 2.4? Well, it's 2.4 because most school districts have a walking zone of 2.4 kilometers. So us, Get Kids Out, and Everactive Schools are encouraging you to explore your 2.4.
To stay healthy now more than ever, you need to get at least 60 minutes of daily activity every day.
Getting outside for walks is one of the most effective ways to do that. And it helps you explore what's inside of your community.
Great, thanks, Wallace. I'll go back to sharing my screen now. Okie dokes. So, marketing trend statistics tell us that viewer habits favor videos. YouTube has over a billion users, almost one third of total internet users, with more than 500 million hours of videos watched on YouTube each day. More video content is uploaded in 30 days than the major US television networks have created in 30 years, and 87% of online marketers use video content. But a picture is still worth a thousand words, and a great photo can tell the whole story. Now that everyone holds a camera in their hands, we can document our stories visually with ease. But before you snap, think about what makes a good photo, and don't forget the basics: subject, light, composition. Not everyone can be lucky enough to grab a shot as epic as its in its storytelling as this, but to get to that good shot, many shutters were pressed. Practice makes perfect, so don't forget to use the power in your pocket, take out your phone, swipe to camera, and click to help you tell your story. Visual storytelling through video, photo, and graphic design is clickbait and is being consumed at a faster and faster pace. If the brain processes images 60 times faster than words, then infographics are a great way to get the fundamentals of your message across. With colorful and fun graphics aimed at your intended audience, an infographic is an eye-catching and effective storytelling tool. But content is still key. Content is everything. Before you start designing, know your goal and know your audience. Ask the questions, what is the purpose of the message I want to convey? And who do I want to convince? Know your audience, yes, but your audience also needs to know you. When creating content, don't forget to use your brand image. This is a great example of an eye-catching graphic with a strong hook, good informational content, and visible branding. And make it personal. Quotes are a fantastic way to bring the audience into the personal side of the story, making it relatable and giving it credibility. Here, a photo also puts a face to a name and draws us further into the personal side of the story and who it affects, making this post potentially more memorable. Communication is becoming easier and easier, and social media use is all pervasive. A like or retweet can take seconds, but when creating a social media storytelling campaign, quality is more important than quantity. A powerful message that will get the point across and resonate with an audience includes a call to action. Click here, retweet, follow, like. A directive action helps your viewer know what to do next and engages your audience to connect further with your story. In this Twitter example, they've used a new and prominent hashtag to promote their COVID rules campaign. On Facebook, the David Suzuki Foundation's call to action here is to sign a petition for Clean Air Day. Speak up and sign. For their post to promote their virtual campfire tomorrow, they want us to click to download the do-it-yourself camp-in kit. Greenpeace's Instagram post here is a great example of all the elements of a good post. A good image with a graphical message supported by informational content that is followed with a question. What does your ideal city look like? Then they ask us, the viewer, to tell them our story and use campaign hashtags to further the storytelling trail. This is a great way to garner audience engagement. Informative and relevant. In Greenpeace's Facebook post here, they have used a compelling quote from an article and are asking viewers to change the narrative by following Black STEM Unity and share the experiences with the hashtags Black AF in STEM, Black Lives Matter, Black Birders Week. As we're learning now in everything going on, hashtags can make a big difference. And taking the call to action beyond the usual clicks, here is Jay Krause, co-chair of Cycle Hamilton, giving his viewers an example of his action to donate and calling on his audience to find ways to support and share his cause. On a lighter note, using humor is a terrific way to get your message across. My 13-year-old is all about the memes and swears I couldn't possibly get them. For those of you that, like me, want to prove my son wrong, a meme is a humorous image, video, or piece of text that is copied and spread rapidly by internet users. Scientifically, it is an element of culture or behavior that is passed from one individual to another by non-genetic means, especially imitation, analogous to the transmission of genes, and hence, interestingly enough, was coined by evolutionary biologist Richard Dawkins. So storytelling is accessible to everyone, and everyone should be doing it. Make it a team sport. Get everyone in your organization on board. It takes time, but soon your friends, staff, volunteers, board members will be looking for stories too. Ask people to email you a story. Make it simple and easy for them to share with you. To find a great story, we need to look and listen for it. Listen for the types of stories your funders, volunteers, etc. want. Listen in person, listen online. Talk to people, ask questions, then lean back and let them talk. Don't settle for the short or first answer. ask follow-up questions to get to that great story that is just waiting to be told. Keep your eyes and ears open for stories in your community, build a story bank for future content, host a storytelling contest such as London's where they turned story submissions into videos, or Ottawa's where they engaged a large high school audience and had terrific success. A contest is a great way to generate content in your community. And don't just look only for the easy or good stories. Search for the ones where someone took a detour, made a mistake, or hit an obstacle. Failures are great examples of how to positively profile organizations' mistakes. Don't work with the end in mind. Allow a story to reveal itself. Write it down. When something significant or memorable happens, get it down on paper. Once the event has passed, we lose some of the crucial details that enliven a story. So listen, be personal, and inspire action. Start storytelling. I'd like to call on any volunteers that have a 2-minute story to share with us now.
I think if anyone has a story they'd like to share, if you could maybe just use the, you should have a hands up tool in the participants window, and you could put your hand up. Is there anybody out there that wants to? Oh, I see one from Army.
Woohoo!
So Army, I've unmuted you.
Hello.
Share your story, Army.
Thanks, Army.
And maybe introduce yourself to those on the call that don't know you.
Hi, this is Army DeFrancia from the town of Ajax. And I'd like to share a story from my Green Communities Canada days where I was working as a school travel planning facilitator. So I was staying with my parents in Pickering. And I had a late morning meeting that took in the neighboring town, the town of Ajax, with a school there. So I had to get there somehow. And my dad left me the car on the driveway. So at least I had that option. But when I looked outside, I noticed that there was construction blocking the driveway. And I wasn't able to get out with the car. Thankfully, I had bought a bike the evening before. And unfortunately, it was too late for me to take transit at that point, just because it would have taken much longer and it would have involved a couple transfers and at least a 10-minute wait at each of those stops. But I had my bike. So I biked to the meeting. I took my laptop with my 15-inch heavy laptop, put it in a bag, strapped it on my shoulder, was wearing a red dress shirt, and I managed to get to the meeting on time. And fortunately enough, the school is actually near the waterfront trail. So I even got to see some amazing views on the way there. And I was very lucky because I had that option. And if we had more direct routes leading to that school in Pickering, I would have been able to get there even faster. So that's just an example of how if we expand our transportation options, then we wouldn't be so limited. It's just car or transit. Thanks for listening.
Thanks, Army. Thank you so much for sharing your personal transportation story. And I'm sure that it's something that we'll all remember. So that's it from me. Thanks. I'll pass it on back to you, Wallace.
Okay. Thanks, Fenella. Does anyone have any questions or comments for Fenella? You can use the chat box for that. I think in the interest of time, we'll move on to the next presentation, Fenella, and you can keep an eye on the chat box for any comments or questions from your presentation. But thanks for kind of doing that deep dive on the cultural and historical origins of storytelling and how that's evolved over time, and how we all need to be thinking more about how we can tell those more personalized stories. I know for me, two things really stand out from the examples that you showed, and one is pulling on the heartstrings, particularly with Tom Flood's videos, and also the use of humor. I really liked that example, the meme example that you showed. I think it was about making sure people register their child for the school bus, and in my decade or so working in the area of after school travel, I can't think of many examples of us approaching our cause with a sense of humor. So that's really something that I'm going to be thinking about more going forward. Okay, so now we're going to transition to our next presenter, who is Leslie Maxwell from Student Transportation Services in Waterloo Region. They say a picture is worth 1,000 words, but we don't necessarily need that many to effectively tell an active school travel story. Leslie is here this morning to show us how, in the age of Instagram and Twitter, words still matter. Over to you, Leslie.
Thanks, Wallace. Good morning, everyone. I'm Leslie, and I'm here to talk a little bit about how written stories can compel a change in behavior. Many stories do, like fairy tales. Hansel and Gretel stopped us from entering into dark forests. The Three Little Pigs showed us that the easy way isn't always the best way. And Little Red Riding Hood got us to invest in quality eye care. You're in a position to share stories that will compel people to support and use active travel. And today, I want to offer some of the ideas that I've learned studying and earning a master's degree in professional writing, and even more so through practicing writing. I'm going to focus on one particular story, which we've asked you to read ahead of time. If you've done so, you'll be a little more familiar with my references. And if you haven't done so, I'll assume that you've been consumed with the headlines this week and you get a pass. The story we're looking at today is called Don't Step on Lava. It was written by Lindsay Ford for the Holistic Parent magazine. This magazine targets parents who are interested in natural health and wellness. I'm going to focus on three interrelated ideas, and Caroline touched on some of them. I'm going to try to bring them all together for you. The first is that your stories are valuable. We all have stories from our personal experience that can move people. You can tell your stories in your position, or you can help others tell theirs to make change happen. In Don't Step on Lava, Ford tells a story of herself as a parent walking to school with her child. The details she shares to convey her perspective are commonly experienced and do not need to be contrived because they are from her true experience. When you tell real stories, you'll find similar details are at the ready because they're truly human experiences. Note that while Ford could have told this story from a number of relevant perspectives, as shown here on the screen, she chose to write from the parent's perspective because it related directly to her audience. Consider for a moment all the perspectives that you personally hold that can have an impact on the way you tell a story, and how those could be selected as per the story that you are going to tell. And if you have any doubt that you have stories, ask yourself, how did I get to school when I was young? How does that relate to my purpose now? How did I get to work yesterday? What have I seen happening at schools lately? Any one of these stories, and they're just a couple, could move people to support or use active travel. Even if you were driven to school as a child, and even if you're brand new to this work. The second idea I want to highlight is that your reader is ready to read. Believe it or not, people do still read. In fact, Atlantic Magazine reports that millennials are outreading older generations. But I would assert that the way they read is changing to myriad formats, from blogs to books to news stories to social media posts. The beauty of the written word is that people can spend time with it at their own pace and when they are ready to absorb it. And for Wallace's sake, I'll throw this in there. There's no technical glitches if you're reading from print, and no photo permissions or fewer photo permissions would be required to produce a written story. Studies show that in comparison to watching stories, reading actually promotes greater comprehension and it stokes greater imagination. And these are key responses that we want from our audiences, from parents who are going to make the shift to walking, all the way up to our decision-making stakeholders. Our stories need to be where our readers read. In Holistic Parent magazine, Ford finds an audience that is especially ready for a story from a parent's point of view, rather than her perspective, say, as a parenting coach or as a manager of planning at a school board. And because she had that audience in mind when she wrote it, the parents' perspective brought us a story that was easy for me and Ontario Active School Travel and you to share with other parents on social media, in newsletters, and in schools. The third idea is that your message is your power. In Don't Step on Lava, Ford craftily lists the benefits for children that active school travel provides, all the while knowing that her readers already know these benefits. It brilliantly sets up her real message, which is powerful because it challenges a core belief. And it contains a shift that this reader has the power to make. Her challenge is introduced early in the story with the line, "My choice to walk on this rainy day has almost nothing to do with the benefits to my child, and everything to do with my own sanity." In a 1-2 punch, she delivers an idea that is very new to some, that there could be personal benefits for a parent buried in the daily grind of the school commute, and an idea that is new to most, that a parent could feel good choosing something for the benefits it brings to her as a parent, instead of solely for the benefits that it brings to her child. Ford unapologetically makes this choice, and she punctuates the lesson with a phrase that any parent can repeat. "It's me time, and I wouldn't get it otherwise." She lets her reader absorb that zinger while she gives further details of the logistics of an active commute, reasons to make the change, and how it's feasible in a normal family day. At the very end of her story, our author brings the message home again by echoing her repeatable phrase. "It's the only way to get a bit of me time in an otherwise hectic day." Know that your message will have greater power if it is simple and your reader can repeat it to others, giving them the opportunity to spread your message even further. Those are my three ideas. I wanted to keep it quick and simple for you, and something that you can actually take away. It's important to note that these three ideas directly relate to each other, and a shift in one may change the approach you take with the others. Thinking of these three ideas together will help to ensure that your storytelling is as compelling as Ms. Ford's is in Don't Step on Lava. That brings me to the conclusion of my little piece. I will also take questions in the chat box in the interest of time. Thanks.
Great. Thank you, Leslie.
You're welcome.
If anybody has any questions or comments for Leslie yet, we will use the chat box. And we're now going to turn things over to Nina Camilleri from the Ottawa Student Transportation Authority. So while you're bringing up your slides, Nina, I'll do a quick introduction. So our last example from the network today, we started with photos and video. We've had Leslie waxing eloquently about the power of the written word. And we wanted to wrap up today with shining a light on graphic design and graphic design. So Nina's with the Ottawa Student Transportation Authority, and she's using a combination of strong messaging combined with professional graphic design to grab the attention of students and parents as part of a forthcoming school zone safety campaign. So over to you, Nina. I'm going to make sure that you've unmuted. Let's unmute you, Nina.
There we go.
There we go.
Okay.
All right.
Can
onwards.
Everyone hear me?
Okay. They can.
Perfect. So our story is a campaign, a safety blitz campaign that we're running. And now we had started this a few months ago, and it's actually become even more relevant with everything that's surrounding COVID. So worked out well that we had held off on launching this because we're going to be launching it in the fall. So the campaign was developed as a way to create safer school zones, and which is something that every school deals with. So our first step was to identify which major issues we wanted to run with. Longstanding issue for us and for all schools are is congestion in school zones. So to really, when we were approaching this this campaign and the design behind it, we decided that we needed to cut through the clutter and we really wanted to have impact. There's a lot of communication that circulated to both students and parents. And so we thought about how do we cut through this? So we decided that we wanted the pieces to be simple, bold, and with very targeted messages. And we hope that by using this strategy, we can begin to change parent perception and behavior by forcing them to recognize that they themselves are part of the problem and offer solutions for change. If we can begin to change parent behavior and encouraging more students to use their seat on the bus, walk and roll, or walk a block, then we can be on our way to relieving congestion and create safer school zones. So the following pieces I'm about to show were circulated with our OSAT network here in Ottawa for feedback, and it's received a very positive response and some very helpful comments as well. So the first piece is actually a really fun piece. It's a pedestrian safety tip. So this is a kindergarten handout to both parents and to the youngsters. So a way to increase walking to school, we thought we need to offer resources and educate both parents and students to help ease anxieties over active transportation. So we wanted to target children as well as parents to instill healthy habits young while they still enjoy and are excited about walking to school. So with this piece, we decided to use whimsical animal characters as a way to tell the story. It's a way to keep children interested. The infographic style was used because, again, it's a good way to tell a story and a good way to highlight all the little individual tips. So this piece was done in a way that both parents and children can read and learn together. Now onto something a little bit more serious, the school bus safety features. So as you know, everyone's well aware, there's anxieties about busing. There's anxieties about everything, basically. So we're here to try and ease those anxieties. And one way we thought about doing that is to highlight the safety that surrounds the yellow school buses and to help create more positive perceptions around all modes of transportation. So in this piece, each safety feature was highlighted to better educate parents and to highlight the safety requirements that are set out by Transport Canada. So by highlighting all the safety features on a bus, we can start to change that negative perception that parents have towards it. Now this one I was really happy with the outcome of this one as well. I think again, it's bold, straight to the point. And it works well with the last piece as well. So parents, as we know, don't often see themselves as the problem. So by highlighting the individual, we might be able to start to push them to take some responsibility and actively participate in a solution. This piece shows how problems in school zones are compounded by each individual parent who chooses to drive instead of letting their child ride the bus or walk. So we kept these styles, these two pieces, very simple, bold headlines to create impact. The distracted driving, again, an issue that, you know, we're all aware of and concerned over. So this, with unsafe driving habits, we started with distracted driving as the first one. As you know, there's many more. So we see this as being something that'll be built on. We wanted each parent to recognize their bad habits and to take action towards change. Illustrations were used as they lend themselves well to other forms of media like video. So the goal is to turn these into some animated videos. So although this piece is directed towards parents, children can also learn about safety issues. It may help them identify potential hazards in their school zone or community. A first person point of view was used to draw the connection immediately to the individual. Safety in your school zone. This is a snapshot, and it was a good way for parents and children to see all of the issues in their school zone and a way to offer resolutions to the problems. For each infraction or bad behavior, we offered an alternate option. Avoid U-turns. Why? They're not necessarily illegal. However, you can drive around the block instead. No illegal parking, walk the block instead. So that way we can stop it on its heels of, yeah, but it's easier for me to do this. Well, we've offered an alternate option for you. The isometric view was used as a way to highlight all of the issues at once to show how the problem is compounded on a daily basis with each infraction. In these campaigns, we work to counter the objections right from the onset by offering solutions to parents. It's hard to argue when there's an alternate way of doing something. So that wraps up the safety blitz comm pieces. Now, wanted to present the safety competition that we just held, because that ties in nicely. So we, I'd actually in the last time I spoke, we had shown the, that was just at the launch of the competition. So now we've received, the judging's done, we received all of our submissions, and the total were 585 submissions, and that ranged from kindergarten all the way up to grade 12. The takeaway from that were that students also see problems in school zones. We awarded 17 prizes, and we had an overwhelming amount of positive feedback from both parents and students. They loved doing the competition and also seeing other students work. The quality of work was impressive, and we plan on using the ideas or the graphics from the students, obviously with their permission, and it's a way to help promote AST and a way to help promote the students, their work. So some of the themes were say no to distracted driving, pedestrian safety at the crosswalk, convince parents to let their children walk, sustainable transportation. That was just to name a few, there was other. So with such a wonderful response, we're looking at the possibility of running this competition this coming year. So to finish up, we're working on really prompting these messages more powerfully in preparation for September, as we definitely expect parents are likely to drive to school. Okay. Thanks for having me again.
Great, thanks so much, Nina. Does anyone have any questions or comments for her? You can use the chat box for that. I know I have a couple, but I like to give other folks an opportunity to go first. No, it doesn't look like it. Nina, just one quick question from me. With the various materials, I realize that the Safety Blitz campaign is not launched yet. You'll be launching that in the fall. I guess two questions. One, the various materials that you developed, how are you planning to disseminate those? Is it all going to be online and via social media, or will there actually be also, you know, some physical handouts at the schools? The image you had of the single school bus, you know, versus all of those cars, to me just screams, you know, big giant poster that schools could put on their, at the front of the building. So that's the first question. And the other is, because I expect there would be other folks really interested in, quote unquote, borrowing some of your materials and adapting them to their own communities. Is that a possibility, obviously, once you've rolled out your own campaign?
Oh, sure. Thanks, Wallace. Yeah, we can definitely look at that. I can definitely talk to our GM and see if that's a possibility to share. As far as distribution, so the intent was, when we were originally going to launch this with schools being open, was that the pedestrian safety tips, that'll be a handout. They would have, and they still will come the fall now, now that we've held off the launch, that they're going to be available online on our website and then distributed through the schools as posters. As you mentioned, that's how the four were, there's three that were designed as posters to be put up in hallways or at in the admin office. The kindergarten pedestrian sheet is a handout, and that can also be made a poster as well. and the isometric view, the safer school zone view, that is also designed as a poster, horizontal. But everything will be available for download on our website as the PDFs, and we will share them via social media as well.
Great, thanks, Nina. Any other comments or questions for Nina from anyone? Okay. Well, thanks again, Nina, and thanks to all of our presenters for sharing their insights and their experience and their knowledge. As I mentioned at the top, we just wanted to wrap up today with just sort of a fairly unstructured time and open forum. Inviting anyone on the call to share a story. Army was the first the brave one to put her hand up, and I see that Laura was thinking about it but too hesitant. I don't know whether you've bolstered your courage, Laura, and wanted to share that story now. Not to put you on the spot. No? Okay. Well, we wanted to use this time, as I say, if there was anyone else that wanted to share a story or an idea for a story or comment on anything else that they've heard today. As I say, I know I put it out there that I think we're missing a sense of humor. Not necessarily, slap your knee laughter humor, but being a little bit, tongue in cheek when it comes to active school travel. We tend, I think, to be very earnest and serious about it all, and it is a serious issue. But I was wondering if anybody had any thoughts about that. Well, something to mull over, I guess. Oh, Louise wants to share a story. Okay, Louise, did you want to unmute yourself or did you want to type it?
Nope, here I go.
All right, over to you, Louise.
Well, hands up icon, so I use chat instead. Yeah, just thinking about, especially about the don't step on lava story, because that resonated so much with me. Thinking back with my three children, we always walked them to school, but how that translates into other things as well, because at the time we were a single car family. So if one parent was off doing something with one child, we had to figure out what to do with the others. So that became a big issue, especially on Sunday mornings when some of the kids had hockey practice, others were off at church or a different hockey practice. So it just organically worked into, yes, well, why don't we just walk the kids to the hockey arena instead? And I didn't think much of it. So the first time, I threw one hockey bag over my shoulder, walked to the arena, but then felt it in my shoulder for about the whole week afterwards. So that grew into, okay, next time, what can we do? So it grew into, well, we'll put the hockey bag in the wagon. The kids didn't ride in the wagon, but they walked along as well, helped pull the wagon to the arena. And once it came to time when there was more snow on the ground, where they're it's going to be hard getting the wagon through the snow. It was actually the kids that came up with the idea, like, why don't we use a toboggan? Just throw the hockey gear onto the wagon or onto a toboggan instead. You get a lot of looks doing it, but the kids loved it. And it was actually the gentleman that the Zamboni driver made sure, that I had a safe place to park things inside if I needed to. So that was a lot of fun and fond memories for all.
That's a great story, Louise. Thanks for sharing that. Yeah, I think it speaks to, and the article that Leslie highlighted, I think speaks to the value of teasing these stories out of the parents that we're engaging with, because obviously the author of the piece that Leslie was sharing with us was speaking very much from that parent, that parent perspective. And what really struck me about that story, and she mentioned, you know, we've recycled that story. I know Leslie has locally as well, is that it was okay to admit to some parent selfishness, you know, add that into the mix. We're so often trying to appeal to everybody's better angels. Parents have their own selfish needs as well, which that author was free to acknowledge. So I think that was great. Well, I'm looking at the clock and I see that we're 1 minute away from our scheduled end time. So if there aren't any other questions or comments, I think we'll wrap things up now. Would again like to thank everybody who presented today, and also for all of you for dialing in. And as I mentioned before, we will post the recording for the coaching session to Slack. And I just wanted to mention that it's come to my attention that some folks are perhaps not receiving notifications about new content when it comes up on Slack. So just watch for an email from me about that next week. I'd like to try to get to the bottom of that, make sure that everybody is taking advantage of that workspace. So thanks, everybody. Have a good rest of your Friday and have a wonderful weekend.